The scene is familiar. Many of you have been to a Jewish wedding. Others have seen it on movies and television and in the media, wherever you've seen it. But many of you, I'm sure, have been to a wedding. And you know the familiar scene. The rabbi recites the blessing, the ketubah is read, the wine is drunk, and everyone is waiting for the last minute, the height of the wedding, when finally, after all the tension of this ritual is finished, the bridegroom would put his foot, his right foot, on a piece of glass, or usually even a light bulb today, in many cases in Jewish weddings in Israel. The noise is sound, loud, and everybody hears the noise, and all of a sudden, everybody cries, Mazel Tov, Mazel Tov. The orchestra starts to play, everybody is joyful, and the festivities begin. People go and eat and enjoy and so on. So this is very strange, actually, because if you think of Jewish customs and rituals and what they mean and how they develop, you have to ask yourself, what is happening here? What is happening? Why people are so cheerful at this moment? And when you ask people who know why you break a glass at the wedding, they'll tell you to commemorate the destruction of the temple. To commemorate the destruction of the temple, so why are you so happy? Why you say Mazel Tov? Mazel Tov that the temple has been destroyed? I mean, this is really, if you look at it this way, it's clear that this is not the origin of the custom. It's clear that this is something here that should be investigated and seen where this custom comes from and how it developed. And actually, not every Jewish community follows this custom. It's only now, in our time, after the State of Israel has been established in the 50s and on, that, for example, Yemenite Jews have heard that you break a glass in the wedding. Never in Yemen, 2,000 years, no one broke a glass in the wedding. Okay, so this is actually a new Jewish custom, but it's become universal. And some communities that didn't know about it, for example, the chief Sephardi rabbi, the first chief rabbi of Israel, Ben Zion Uziel, in the 50s, was questioning. He said, why people do this? It seems to me so bizarre, this custom. If I can, I'm canceling it. But I know that if there are too many people who follow it. I know it's too, let's say, venerated custom. I cannot do it, but from my own point of view, it should be canceled. No one should be happy at the time that you pronounce the destruction of the temple. So if this is not the reason, where do we hear about breaking of the glass? And actually, you hear about it in weddings. You hear about it on many occasions, on many cultures that are really not Jewish. And we know about breaking of the glass in societies all over the world, from India to Western Europe, that the breaking of the glass is something very symbolic that is done. And actually, the country where this custom has developed, the Jewish custom has been developed, is very well known for practicing this until today. And this is Germany. And we're going to see that all the early sources speaking about breaking of the glass by the bridegroom in the wedding, in the Jewish wedding, come from Germany. And this German custom of breaking the glass the night before the wedding, not on the wedding itself, is practiced until today. Historians of German folklore will tell you that this is pre-Christian in Germany. This comes from the tribes in antiquity, that this was done already at that time, and it still continues to be done today. And, not only one glass is broken, as you can see in this slide. A lot of vessels are broken. And actually, people pronounce this that something that sounds like Mazel Tov, and this is that the shards, the broken glass, brings good luck, brings luck. And this is really the origin of the custom. We'll go and see now how it developed and how it became to be what it is today, but let's see how it was in the Middle Ages when this was really done in this way, more similar to this, and understood as something like bringing good luck, Mazel Tov, what it means, and not something else. And actually, the first time that we hear about this custom in the Middle Ages, although it's mentioned in the Talmud, but in the Talmud, it's not the bridegroom who breaks the glass, and it's not really a custom there, it's just an isolated story. The first time that we hear that this is the practice of bridegrooms to do in the weddings in medieval Germany, it comes from 12th century. It's a certain Rabbi Eliezer Ben Natan of Mainz that mentions this, and he is very surprised at this custom. He's also about to cancel it. This is something that is done by his contemporaries. Many bridegrooms are breaking the glass in Germany in his time. And he says this is against all common sense, Jewish common sense, you can say, because it's against one basic idea of Judaism that's called Bal Tashchit. Bal Tashchit means you are not allowed to damage, to destroy something that can be used, something that is beneficial to you. You cannot cut a tree and just leave it like that unless you needed the wood for fire. You cannot kill an animal unless you're going to eat it. This is Bal Tashchit. So he says, why break a glass? And in his time, and this is very important also to know and understand, in his time, the glass was broken, filled with wine. Filled with wine, unlike what we do today in the Jewish weddings. So he asks, why to break an expensive glass, one? The other thing, why to waste the wine? Of the blessing even, the wine that was just a minute ago, the Rebbe recited the blessing over it. So these are two things that were really strange to him, and he's very surprised at this custom, which shows us that it's really a new custom in his time, that is something he doesn't really understand, and then people who follow him and will mention this, and all the early sources that we have that talk about this custom come from medieval Germany, from this period, from the 12th, 13th, 14th century, and many of them are like surprised why it's done. Each one offers a new solution, and they try, let's say, to Judaize this, because they see that everybody continues to follow it. So, for example, one says it's to show how fragile is life. Another one says, no, that life is transparent, the life of the Jew, it doesn't hide anything from the goyim and so on, so they can see that the glass is shows your inner side, and so on. And there are many other explanations that are given until someone comes with the wonderful idea. There are many customs in the Talmud about how to commemorate the destruction of the temple. So he offers this. It's this source that offers this now. Sefer Kolbo, it's called this source, that maybe we break the glass to commemorate the destruction of the temple. This now reason that is given by one source and it's not heard again for several time, for several hundred years until later that is repeated again, becomes the standard one. And by the time, let's say, it reaches other communities, that's how this custom is known. Breaking of the glass at the wedding is to commemorate the temple. But even by the 16th century, centuries later, when the Shulchan Aruch is written by Rabbi Yosef Karo, he never heard of this, he doesn't mention this in the laws of wedding. Yes, because for him it was something very strange. He didn't understand where it comes from, what it means. Only later that it becomes also a Sephardi custom. So let's see how it was done in Germany in the time that they still believe this is something to bring good luck. So first of all, you have to know how the German Jewish wedding was conducted. It was conducted outside the synagogue. Outside the synagogue, always on the same corner of the synagogue, always in the same spot. You look here in the synagogue of the city of Firth, and you can see the Torah Ark. Okay, the people are standing outside, and this is the northern wall of the synagogue. Always the weddings were conducted on the northern side of the synagogue. Okay, and in this wall of this synagogue, there is a stone. Look at this stone that we're going to see in a second. Okay, so you see in many of the images that we have from this period done mostly by Christian artists, by the way, that showed the Jewish wedding, all the congregation is outside the northern wall, and that's where the chuppah is taking place. Of course, there is the reason for that, that is given to see the stars in heaven, and that's to have many children, like the blessing that was given to Abraham in the book of Genesis, but there are other reasons as well. So the next stage, after they finish the blessings, after the chuppah is finished, yes? So we see now what's happening, the moment that is now, the crucial moment is the bridegroom that is marked with the letter A is now turning to the northern wall. The bridegroom, you see him marked with the letter A, the bride is on the left there, and he's holding this jar, actually, this vessel filled with wine, and he's shattering it against the northern wall. And there is a description by the Maharil, one of the leading rabbis, leading authorities of late 14th century Germany that describes how this was done. And he says that he should turn into this side, this direction to the north and break the glass filled with wine. The reason for that is very clear, okay? The reason is very clear because from north evil comes. This is a verse in Jeremiah that evil comes from the northern side, and now they prepare to fight against the demons. The demons, really the belief was that they're going to harm the bride and the bridegroom, and you need to protect them in all measures that you can do. So breaking of the glass against this wall at this moment is really to do this protection. What is happening is that the glass that is filled with wine will now seduce the demons to come to this moment because they want to harm the bride and bridegroom. But then they are bribed by the wine. They will drink it. The demons love wine, as you know from folklore, yes, folkloristic traditions. And then they will get wounded by the shattered glass. So they cannot harm the bride and bridegroom. So that's why everybody is so happy, because this moment has passed, the bridegroom are saved, and you say Mazel Tov. You say Mazel Tov, and actually the stone upon which you break the glass is a special stone with many magical designs. On it is written in large letters, Mazel Tov, as we see. And then Kol Sason, we call Simcha, Kol Chatan, we call Kala. This is abbreviated. This is the Chupashtein upon which they broke the stone, and there is an image of the star. The star here means Mazal. Mazal Tov means may you have a good constellation. May the star be with you. May you be protected by the constellations in heaven. That's why it's done under heaven. That's what you mean when you say Mazal Tov. And actually, on many of these Chupashteins, there is the design of the Star of David, of the Magen David, the Shield of David. It protects in the name of David. It's not the Zionist symbol until the 19th century. In the past, it was really a magical design. Yes, that's how it was understood. It appears in this way on many of the Chupashteins. By the way, we have about 18 that survived the Holocaust. Not that there were many, especially in Bavaria, but they're gone by now. So you see them again. David is the central symbol. If you look at amulets that were produced in Germany of the 18th century and before, the central design is the Magen David. And inside this Magen David, inside this Shield of David, is written the name of God, as God as fighter, God as general, Adonai Tzvaot, Lord of hosts, that he can go and fight for you. And in the corners of the Magen David, Kras Satan, you call God to cancel the power of the demons, of the devils. Yes, this is how this emblem was understood. And you see that around the Magen David, there are the zodiac signs, because you won't have to have this occasion of the wedding or childbirth to be in a good constellation. So you write at the top of the page, Mazel Tov, you illustrate all the zodiac signs and the Magen David in the center. So actually, it's not only in the wedding, also in childbirth, for example, you can see that when a baby is born, here is a scene from Germany from the 16th century. When a baby is born, the midwives are around the woman with the baby, and there are the astrologers in the back of the picture are looking at the map of the stars in heaven to see whether this child was born under good constellation with Mazal Tov, So all these beliefs, all these, let's say, practices that, let's say, were sound so strange to the rabbis, so, let's say, un-Jewish, they tried to do away with them. And they convinced us, and by now everybody's convinced, that you break the glass because of the destruction of the temple. But of course, that the original reason was forgotten, and now most people don't know that this was the reason. And today, I just want to end with this. Today, when the glass is broken, the wedding, this is the glass from the wedding of my daughter, and that's how she was able to come with a new solution for this. You put it inside this foam, that it's really the silicone, that actually there are no shreds of glass, no one is wounded, no demons are hurt. I mean, even not the guests of the wedding, nothing happens to them. But the custom continues, the ritual continues, because this is what keeps us as a group. You have the ritual that everybody does, no matter what it means so much, but you follow the tradition. This is tradition, that's what all about. You do the exterior thing, the meaning is somehow lost or changing in time. Thank you so much.